we're still getting used to this new space, which involves all kinds of future tech. Currently, we're using past tech, so we're having to run all of our cords from the front to the back every night. It's a lot of fun, but it takes us a little bit. Welcome to Writing About TV. I have to say, I love this program. It was started by students. We had a bunch of students who came together who said, you know, we talk about television so much. We want to honor television in a really formal way, where so it's not just the talking in the kitchen. It's not just the talking over breakfast. It's not just the talking in our classes or between our classes. We want to really think about television together and publicly, both as an art form and as this communal shared activity, this thing that many of us just do and do a lot of. I think there's a sense that we needed smart talk about TV, partly because we as a culture come together so much and spend so much time watching it. These days, I feel like there's so much TV out there, it's really hard to keep up. So I also like this program because it reminds me of shows that I love. It reminds me of shows that I haven't yet had a chance to look at. It's kind of a continual reminder that this is it in many ways. This is our novel. This is our contemporary culture. This is where a lot of good writing is happening. But to give this program some shape, what we do is we invite our Writers House community, our planning committee, also called the Hub, we invite them to come together and think of a topic that would be interesting for us to hear about. And we vote on a topic, and this year the topic was magic. And then we invite 6, 7, 5 people, this year it's six people, to write about a TV show using that shared theme. So this year, that shared theme of magic is what inspired our 6 speakers/readers/talkers/TV talkers. One of the presenters said, well, what do you mean by magic? Can I make up my own magic? And we didn't have anything particular in mind, so absolutely yes. One of the ideas of this program is that we are each experts in the way we watch television. We're each experts in our own sense as viewers. We're each experts in things like magic. I hope we are all experts in magic, actually. So what magic means is totally open for interpretation. What will happen then is I will invite each speaker to come up. I will introduce them very briefly. I'll say like 2 things about each one of them. They'll each share their TV show in relation to our theme, magic. And then at the end, we will all eat TV dinner-inspired food. It's mac and cheese, peas, brownies. It's going to be delicious. So that's our plan. We'll have 6 speakers, magic, and then TV dinner magic to follow. So I'll go ahead and we'll jump right in. And there might be a couple of interperson moments when we're getting the tech set up. I think we got it all, but there might be 1 or 2 transitions that are fun. Okay, first up is Jamie Albrecht. Jamie is a poet from LA who reads and reads and reads without hoping to get anything out of it. Jamie will be speaking tonight about Scooby-Doo. Here's Jamie.
Okay. preparing for this, I scroll through pages of search results, trying to find a site that'll give me what I asked for. Scooby-Doo, where are you? Watch free. Fortunately, I come across some scramble playlists after my 4th search attempt. Reclining into the couch, my friend Julia asks why I'm on a potentially illicit site with Scooby-Doo pulled up in a 20-episode queue. The theme song and first few minutes are cut off, and I can't seem to relax into it. Then I find a clean corporate site and make a fake account so I can stream the uncorrupted files. The unclipped theme song plays, and I slip back in. I'm on familiar grounds, speaking in familiar terms with familiar folks. Shaggy's shaky knees, Velma's perspicacious glasses, Fred's ascot and kempt white sweater, Daphne's curious staring about, Scooby's hazy grin. I'm in another world now, removed by 40 years from its pilot. Closer to 30, if I'm 5, watching it with Rosebud on my couch. Rosebud, whose color was too close to Scooby's for me to not have noticed something suspect was happening. And as I sit on this couch, squeezed tightly next to Julia, who's next to Julius, Shaggy musters up some courage without any prompting other than Fred's asking. He clambers up the ladder, propped up on a jack, and swings through the square hole in the brick and down through the floor and high ceiling, all this while winking. I slip into the narrative arc. Ghost or ghoul or ghost of a ghoul shambles towards Shag and Scoob, and they run off jittery to the rest of the gang. They investigate, splitting up and looking for clues. A slip of paper, a maniacal laugh, a very human hand. All these familiar symbols say that the ghost may not be a ghost. We think we might be working with a mask, and it's up to the gang to peel back the layers of the world around them. Fred, in his paternalistic way, attempts to orchestrate the capture and organize how we're going to come face to face with what lies beneath the ghost. Shaggy's the bait for the snow ghost, and Scooby's meant to freeze him with the water in the bucket at his feet. But Scooby's tapped on his shoulder, and he's become the bait. The scene snowballs out of control, and the whole gang is wrapped up in feet of snow, their plans unraveled, and the villain's mask finally torn off. The transparent skis the monster used to fly are strapped to Scooby's feet and are finally visible. And the masks that we believed in, that the animators believed in, are revealed to be forms of play. The onset laughs, scoring, and animation never really occurred to me as intrusive. Rather, they were rules of the game. I slip in and out of the reality of the show before the Dick Van Dyke laugh tracks become ambient and cling to the walls of the drawn set. But as soon as I'm drawn into this world and lulled back onto my couch with my dog Rosebud, a spot staring quizzically at Scooby, a mask is pulled back. In the first episode of Scooby-Doo, Where Are You?, the knight in the museum trips over Velma and tumbles straight into the creaking pillory, grunting and yowling with no consequence to Velma, as if her body were a boulder. Scooby flaps as hard as he can with two trash can lids and becomes an aircraft zooming about the werewolf ghost in the watermill. Returning, it is these moments of anti-narrative and senselessness which unmask. Scooby had become the bait earlier in that episode and becomes a Pegasus in this one. Velma becomes an immutable body to the knight's foot. Daphne isn't always the bait, and Fred's paternalistic plans are constantly unseated. In these moments of anarchy, all masks get torn off, including the familiar roles which people so often accuse children of running to for comfort. The laws of physics are even up for grabs. I'm laughing and familiar with this unfamiliarity, the disjunct lack of rules of the world around me. And I think about the maskless villain, naked with his greed, and how Scooby and Shaggy and Freddy and Daphne and Velma run around rewardless in some liminal and youthful era. And how, after revealing that the ghost of the werewolf was just an entrepreneurial capitalist floating sheep down in the river, magic is still possible. Scooby soars, and that really is a ghost chasing them down the hall in episode 5. Wonder is woven into the space, but deep at the heart of this wonder is a skepticism and a prompting to question. The gang asks you to enjoy them and their strangeness with them, but also challenges you to move one step ahead, to ask questions before they wink at you, to understand with them as the role shifts and adapts to the needs of those they love, those in need, that you are not fixed but constantly in flux, constantly figuring out the rules of the game and your role. Sometimes Velma is Daphne, is Shaggy, is Scooby, or Fred, that sometimes Shaggy is the first to descend into the bowels of the groaning cave to find the owl monster. I find myself peeling back my own mask and being not a serious writer, but someone whose being encompasses ridiculous pieces which do not fit, and someone who must journey deep beneath my masks, my quotidian masks of productivity, which has no place in the mystery machine. And in this familiar van, rules are meant to be broken. That's all.
Next up, we're going alphabetically. We have Erin Cross. Erin is the director of Penn's LGBT Center. She has a PhD from Penn's Graduate School of Education, specializing in queer, gender, and learning theories in and out of school contexts. She regularly teaches at GSC, has taught at the School of Social Policy and Practice, and has been honored as a model of excellence by Penn four times. Erin is going to speak about Wentworth, a show I have not yet seen and I'm excited to hear about. Please welcome Erin.
I'm the old school paper person. All right, so first, I chose my show because my partner and I did our version of binge watching for this, which means after the kids went to bed, we made it through one episode a night for quite a while. And shout out to Stouffer College House GA, Chanel Boatswain, for suggesting this show in the first place and for us getting deeply involved in it. So Wentworth is TV magic. Magic not because the dark, women-centered drama sucks you into the life of Wentworth Prison and the lives within it to the point of mild obsession, but because it subverts dominant power. How does it do so, and how does that tie into magic? Before I plunge in, however, let's get the basics down. It is not the Australian version of Orange is the New Black. Wentworth, available on Netflix, is a reimagining of a 1980s Australian show, Prisoner, now set in current-day Melbourne. The show begins when Bea, a devoted mom, is incarcerated for the attempted murder of her abusive husband. She's soon put into H Block with a motley crew of multidimensional women as she figures out prison life. There's Liz, the peer worker and older mother hen of the block, Frankie, the punky sexpot lesbian who constantly flirts and wants to be top dog or the inmate in charge, Boomer, the big bone, slightly slow enforcer who just wants human connection, and Doreen, a young woman who desperately wants to be a mother. Add to that a band of correctional officers who are more than flawed humans, and the rest of the amazing ensemble cast, and the day-to-day drama makes for a riveting ride as the season-long storylines successfully hold your attention and pay off in the end. The mysteries are never what they seem to be. The majority of the women in and out of H Block have committed violent crimes. As a result, Wentworth's violence is that much more emotionally devastating. The key to the show is that even as the violent acts are explained, they are not excused. Instead, they become inescapable and inevitable. The show is gory. At the same time, and this takes magical writing, all the characters remain steadfastly human despite their atrocious acts. We see them forge alliances, become lovers, and take comfort in small joys like sharing a cuppa. Yes, we see them being cruel, and I have to admit it's interesting to see what character develops a homemade weapon in a MacGyver-esque way, or who's a fist fighter, but no lag, which is Australian for lying, or shiv competes with having information about someone. No matter how small, information is the most powerful weapon in Wentworth for inmates and correctional officers alike. Wentworth is corruption born, prizing its information-based economy and allowing violence, or the threat of it, to taint every interaction, even between the supposed allies, friends, and lovers. So how is Wentworth magic? Sounds gross and gory. Depends on how you define magic. As I said earlier, I believe Wentworth is magic in terms of something being exciting and unexplainable. But it's more. Late 19th and early 20th century Scottish social anthropologist James Frazer saw magic as a mechanism for controlling events in the world by other than ordinary, everyday actions. He broke the concept down further into the law of similarity and the law of contact. The former is the idea that like produces like, and that the effect of something resembles its cause. The latter is the idea that things that have been in contact with each other will continue to act upon each other even after they're separated. These tenets are borne out in Wentworth time and time again. Repeatedly, the prison's culture, which can be posited as outside ordinary life for most people, reifies itself, both among the women and the overarching corrections culture, as characters resort to blackmail and physical violence to maintain what they deem as control. Moreover, once correctional staff is outside the prison walls, or a woman is released, prison culture continues to pervade the reality. The magic, then, of Wentworth is its somehow incomprehensible comprehensibility exhibited through the humanity of its inhabitants. Powerfully, however, Wentworth is magic in that it subverts dominant power, as Starhawk says magic does on multiple levels. First, Half the show's creative team identifies as women. Most of the actors are women, and many of the directors are women, truly unusual in today's world. It also allows the prisoners to shine as the real peacekeepers of the prison, albeit craftily and mostly violently. The stellar writing enables you to empathize with the characters while still seeing them for who they are. However, the show's not perfect. They have a male actor playing a transgender woman, and now and then, a subplot line is incredibly far-fetched. That said, Wentworth is worth a watch, as you will be drawn in a la Frasier's Law of Contact, because the residents of Wentworth will stay with you far beyond the time they're on the screen. Thank you.
Awesome. Okay, next up we have Rodney Dailey. Rodney has presented at Writer's House a few times for a panel discussion about science and writing, for a discussion of his own writing about and after Virginia Woolf, and also, I would say, informally all the time in the Writer's House kitchen where Rodney basically lives. Tonight, Rodney is speaking about The Crown, another show I haven't seen. Please welcome Rodney.
So I'm going to be talking about The Crown, and The Crown is a biographical web series that covers the reign of Queen Elizabeth, and so I'm going to talk about sort of its lavish design and cinematography. The first season cost a record of $130 million in production costs, which is crazy. And it's birthed out of both a film and a stage play written by Peter Morgan. The film is The Queen, which is directed by Stephen Frears, and it focuses on the death of Princess Diana, which becomes a hot topic in The Crown itself, and The Audience, which is a stage play, and it covers the weekly meetings called Audiences between Queen Elizabeth and her prime ministers. Now, I wanted to talk about the magic as it pertains to the object, to what I call the sublimation of the object, the crown. So from its carefully forged signifiers to those formless ideas that instill fear and fascination, the subject is a mangled mess of semiotics that is the crown. The sublimity of the object in the audience is chiefly American. The fantastic engagement with the form of social organization that's both exotic and familiar. And so I want to play the title sequence, which illustrates this sort of act of sublimation and then kind of break it down after. So the title sequence, with its epic music composed by Hans Zimmer, who's a famous name, illustrates the point. The object is formed in a vacuum with a magnifying eye to its stunning materiality, its composition, when a blast of light silhouettes the object. The sublimation then occurs, eradicating the crown from view entirely. The weight of the language supersedes the object that it signifies. The words "the crown" take the place of the object without us actually seeing the object of the crown in its full glory, I should say. And so, to continue, there's a clip with episode five, entitled Smoke and Mirrors, where the coronation of Queen Elizabeth takes place. And so here, there's a break in mythology. There's a demystification that retains the sublimity of the object. There's a portrayal of the true scale of its influence, its reach, with the advent of new technologies to broadcast the coronation, and a superposition and overload of signifiers that overlay and undermine the drama and momentousness of the Queen's coronation. So as I said before, the drama is both exotic and familiar, ironically perverted by the union or collapse of law, church, and morality, which are identified to be very separate things. The magic becomes thus the exposé of the poetic daydream, the disembodied eye that wanders through the inaccessible corridors of Buckingham Palace or those sites of royal residence, intensely cross-analyzed with history. It is an imagined breach of royal residence, intensely cross-analyzed with its history. It is an imagined breach of divine privacy, a betrayal of the royal family's human condition, a capture of the sadism that ordinates their customs. So to illustrate that, I have
a dialogue,
short dialogue, between Claire Foy, who plays Queen Elizabeth II before her coronation, and Matt Smith, who plays Prince Philip of Edinburgh.
Oh, again, he doesn't understand. Fine. You ought to be...
Oh, yeah, actually, it's self-explanatory.
The overblown ceremony costing a fortune while the rest of the country is on rations. But don't come bleating to me when your head and the heads of our children are on spikes.
People are hungry. They want something that lifts them up.
And how do you propose lifting them if they cannot see it?
The people are looking for something bigger than themselves, an inspiration, a higher ideal. If you put it in their homes, allow them to watch it with their
dinner. Democratize it. Make them feel that they're sharing it. Understand it.
All right. Right. I'll support you in the terrorizing.
You won't regret it.
On one condition. That you mean.
An unattractive sense of authority and entitlement that I have never seen before.
And in you, it's at least a weakness, an insecurity I've never seen before.
Are you my wife or my queen?
I'm both.
I want to be married to my wife.
I am both, and a strong man will be able to kneel to both.
I will not kneel before my wife.
Your wife is not asking you to.
But my queen commands me.
Yes.
I beg you make an exception for me.
No.
That was a lot. That was a lot, period. Period. It's really, period. And so, furthermore, the titling of the episodes argues this case. The previous episode portrays the consequences of London's major industrialization, the Great Smog of London, where 4,000 people died and 100,000 people fell ill due to the severe air pollution event, mostly caused by the use of coal. This episode, the Great Smog of London, is entitled Act of God. Sees London brought to his knees via suffocation, while the following episode, this episode, is called Smoke and Mirrors, the coronation episode, which finds London bowing at the sublimation of the crown. And I want to end with this quote by the Duke of Windsor, who's literally watching the coronation on BBC in Paris. He says, "Why have transparency when you can have magic?" Period.
I'd take that as a mantra. Why have transparency when you can have magic? Next up, Torinn Fennelly. Torinn is an English major and a Philadelphia native. She was, I need to say, the brains behind the wonderfully disgusting edible books entry, The Sprout Ciders. Yes, that was you. It was gross. It was awesome. She's also the editor-in-chief of Penn's online film magazine, The Moviegoer. And tonight she's going to speak about Mad Men, which is enough a part of her life that it makes it into her Moviegoer bio. Please welcome Torinn.
Hi. I have always been somewhat of a TV obsessive. As a child, I would always leave my friend's house before 3 o'clock to make sure I would be home in time to watch Sailor Moon. By high school, I rooted for Aiden over Big. I took a day off school to mourn McDreamy's death. I've often half joked that I did so poorly on the SATs because I spent the majority of my junior year of high school staying up late watching Breaking Bad. Just one more episode, yet no television show has ever entranced me the way Mad Men has. As with most loves, it didn't happen immediately. It was a slow burn. The first season demands patience to move through. It requires forbearance to fall in love with the characters in spite of their most unlovable traits. Don is an adulterer. Betty is petulant. Joan is vain. Roger is entitled. But by the season one finale, the now iconic episode The Wheel, it is near impossible not to see the magic of the show. When pitching his ad campaign for Kodak's new slide projector, Don says this device isn't a spaceship, it's a time machine. In addition to becoming one of the touchstone quotes of the golden age of television, these words sum up the magic of Mad Men itself. Mad Men offers us a window into our shared past, allowing us to take pride in the ways America has progressed and prudently discern the ways it has not since that most turbulent era of our history. The show folds seminal moments in American history seamlessly into the characters' lives and their development. The death of Marilyn Monroe particularly strikes Joan, one of the most beautiful women in the office. Joan says about Monroe, "This world destroyed her." What initially seems like a throwaway nod to the past is actually a catalyst for Joan's growth as a character. Monroe's death makes Joan realize that she wants to be more than a sex symbol and emboldens her to use her beauty as a means of gaining true financial security for herself and eventually her son. Joan sleeps with an executive at Jaguar to land the account for the advertising agency. And though the decision to do so comes at her own personal expense, she leverages her choice into a position as partner at the firm. At one point, she even invokes Betty Friedan when she's being mistreated. By the end of the show, she's running her own company. The assassination of John F. Kennedy plays out alongside the disintegration of Betty and Don's marriage. Situations which both culminate in Betty shrieking, "What is happening?" These moments serve to demonstrate the pervasive confusion of the era and the emotional toll these crises took. Mad Men makes historical moments, the Beatles at Shea Stadium, the assassination of Martin Luther King, the Vietnam War, feel intensely personal. These moments belong to everyone, and they have become so embedded in our culture that it can be hard to feel the magnitude of their significance. Like magic, Mad Men restores their power. It seems obvious to declare that a television show set in the 1960s is about the past, but it is more apt to say that the show is about how the past engages with the present. Don Draper is the personification of this idea. Born Dick Whitman, Don escapes his tragic, impoverished childhood by adopting the identity of a fallen soldier during his service in the Korean War. Don steals the soldier's tag, symbolically killing himself. There's a memorable shot of Don staring out the window of a train car as he watches the coffin, thought to contain his own body, being carted away. This action haunts Don throughout the show and leaves him constantly struggling with imposter syndrome. No matter how much money he makes or how beautiful his wife is, material success can never be enough for him. At his core, he feels unworthy. A scene in season 3 demonstrates this best. After discovering Don's true identity, Betty snarls at him. "What would you do if you were me? Would you love you?" To which Don replies, "I was surprised that you ever loved me." Because Don never had a home and he grew up in utter chaos, he only feels like himself when his life is in disarray, when he is having an illicit affair, when he is falling down drunk, when he is experiencing shame. Don represents the most American of stories, drawing on the most American of magic, the ability to make yourself new, to escape all past and personal history, to become the person you most want to be. This promise, one that the entire advertising agency is built on, proves hollow for Don because it is not rooted in any spiritual fortitude. However, his example allows his progeny Peggy to courageously forge her own path. Peggy is both ridiculed and objectified in the office, particularly by Pete. Later in season one, Pete and Peggy have sex, which unbeknownst to Peggy results in her becoming pregnant. Don visits her in the hospital and encourages her to put the baby up for adoption and move forward with her own life, as if the whole situation never happened, which is exactly what Peggy does. And unlike in other television shows, Peggy is never punished for her rejection of motherhood. Instead, just the opposite happens. Peggy learns to voice her own opinions, and even when she's surrounded only by men, and she works her way up from secretary to become one of the top copywriters at Sterling Cooper. Peggy's experiences as a woman, as an outsider, endow her with a grit and ambition that cannot be rivaled by any of her male coworkers. Mad Men's focus on women, particularly the depictions of Peggy and Joan, is the foremost reason I love the show. Handled by less skillful writers, the women characters most certainly would have been confined to the stereotypes they initially seemed to embody. In most television shows, Joan would be written off as the whore who trades sex for personal gain, and Peggy would be labeled icy and frigid, ruthlessly obsessed with her work. Mad Men, however, plays to the nuances of each woman, of their intelligence, and their pragmatism. It permits each of its characters to move beyond what is expected of them, as long as the character is bold enough to take the steps necessary for growth. Since women today are still not paid as much as men, and continuously have their value based primarily on their sex appeal, there is something so empowering about watching women of the show endure the cruelties of everyday sexism and prosper in spite of it. These moments make me want to honor all women who have made room for me and remind me that I have a responsibility to make room for the generation of women after me. As Bert Cooper remarks about a secretary who dies at her desk in my favorite episode of Mad Men, she was born in 1898 in a barn. She died on the 37th floor of a skyscraper. She was an astronaut. Joan and Peggy, too, are astronauts, surpassing the boundaries of the world they grew up in order to create meaningful lives independent of male influence. In this way, Mad Men is also a spaceship, encouraging us to imagine a new world, the one America promises to be, where a person's value is based solely on their talent and hard work rather than their appearance or circumstance. This notion plays out throughout the show. An episode in season 7 sees Don driving down the road as David Bowie's Space Oddity plays. Though Don spends most of the show emotionally divorced from everyone in his life, seemingly living in his own orbit, this choice of song demonstrates that Don is also an astronaut. He's moving into a greater spiritual understanding of himself. Don's relationship with Peggy and his decision to allow her to take the lead on the Burger Chef account is part of what triggers his spiritual awakening. In an episode set against the backdrop of the 1969 moon landing, a moment in history that reminds us both of our human limitations and our ability to surpass them, Peggy delivers a moving pitch for Burger Chef, one that is reminiscent of Don's for the Kodak slide projector. Speaking of the moon landing, Peggy says, "I don't know if it was the technological achievement or the fact that we were all doing the same thing at the same time. Sitting in this room, we can still feel the pleasure of that connection. We were starved for it. We really were." She goes on, her words eerily parallel our own uncertain cultural climate now. The TV is always on, Vietnam is playing in the background, the news wins every night, and you're starving, and not just for dinner. This connection that Peggy speaks of is precisely what Mad Men offers its viewers, what it reminds us that we need. The magic of Mad Men lies in its ability to make us connect more deeply with ourselves, with each other, with the history that we share and the figures who brought us to where we are now. The show's magic is in its message that we cannot get where we need to be until we honor who we have been. The show does exactly what television should. It connects us.
All right, we have two more, and then TV dinners. There's a Billy Penn piece that starts off, "Mikey Ilagan is that Philly guy everyone knows." And it's true. Mikey is well known to most Philly people, in large part because of his active and vocal support of geek culture. So we're particularly thrilled, or I am at least, to have Mikey here to speak about what I think of as one of the epitomes of geek culture, and that is Star Trek Next Generation. Please welcome Mikey.
Thank you. Yes. Just getting situated here with my two laptop situation. So I'm here to talk about the magic of Star Trek Next Generation, specifically a certain character by the name of Q, who I call humanity's biggest pest and greatest stan, which is stalker fan. So in Star Trek The Next Generation, we're introduced to an omnipotent character named Q. He's an extremely powerful, extremely vexing, extra-dimensional entity. He's been described as obnoxious and a pest. The character left behind a legacy despite appearing only a dozen times in the entire Star Trek franchise, 8 times in The Next Generation, once in Deep Space Nine, and 3 more times in Star Trek Voyager. He remains a fan favorite and beloved character by the fandom. The Q episodes are among my very favorite. Let me tell you about them. Q is a godlike, is part of a godlike and immortal species of mysterious continuum of aliens, all of whom are named Q. Their origins are unknown. They can conjure anything they wish. Every Q has the ability to instantaneously transform matter and energy. They can teleport themselves, other people, and whole spaceships. They can travel through time and take others along for the ride. They can take any form. The Q that we know best has appeared as a giant serpent, but usually takes the form of a human male wearing some form, wearing something from human history, such as the Starfleet uniform of those he's addressing. They know all there is to know about life, the universe, and everything in it. The Q have control over all of space, time, matter, and reality itself. It's unknown how many there are, where they come from, or what the source of their power is, and in spite of all this power, the Q simply do not understand mortality. They don't understand what drives what they'd consider lesser races or species. They have no concept of mortal wishes or desires. They can't relate to the need to explore or learn more about the universe around them. That's the main thing that drives the meddling between the Q, well, one specifically, and humans on Star Trek. The Q that we're familiar with serves as a major antagonist throughout The Next Generation, playing a pivotal role in both the first and final episodes. Q is initially presented as a cosmic force, judging humanity to see if it is becoming a threat to the universe. But as the series progresses, his role morphs into one of a teacher or even friend to Captain Picard in the human race, albeit often seemingly destructive or disruptive ways, subject to his own amusement. Underneath his sour attitude and beyond his manipulative tricks, there seemed to be a hidden agenda to Q's visits that often had the best interest of humanity at their core. I think this isn't moving, so I'm going to hit play. All right. The Federation first encounters Q when he appeared aboard the USS Enterprise in the first episode of the Star Trek. Ooh, it's all right. All right. The Federation first encounters Q when he first appeared aboard the USS Enterprise in the first episode of The Next Generation. Showing up in the middle of their bridge, Q interrupts the crew while on their first mission to examine a new planetary station for trade. He accuses them of being dangerous, of being a dangerous, savage child race, and literally puts humanity on trial to determine whether or not they should be destroyed. He cites references to humanity's dark and violent past. Ultimately, Captain Picard and his crew pass this first test and prove that humans aren't barbaric and inferior when they continue their mission to the new station and save the life of a kidnapped alien entity. Q disappears, but vows that this wouldn't be the last time he'd be seen. Later that year, Q appears on the bridge of the Enterprise and informs the crew that the Q Continuum, after studying their recent contact with humanity, are most impressed by them and wish to discuss it. He creates a bizarre and deadly game for the ship's crew. In order to demonstrate that he had given Commander Riker Q-like abilities, his motives for this were that humans had a desire to grow and explore, which his species, the Q, did not have or understand. Q wanted Riker to join the Continuum so they could understand and possess this desire. Q believes that humanity has the potential to one day evolve beyond the Q, and he wants to understand how. Q and Picard settled on a bet that if Riker rejected this offer, the Q would leave humanity alone forever. Ultimately, Riker did reject his new powers, and Q was forced back into the Continuum, and we're left to assume he'll never return. Did Q leave humanity alone forever? As it turns out, you can't trust the word of an all-knowing, all-powerful, eternal entity. Even though humans proved themselves to be peaceful and benevolent, Q wasn't finished with his tests and tricks. He returned in season 2 as if the previous wager had never occurred. Because of losing his bet with Picard, he was kicked out of the Q Continuum. As an omnipotent being without a home, he offers to join the Enterprise crew and act as their guide to the galaxy. His reason was that humanity would eventually push into uncharted territory and they would need a guide. He even offered to renounce his powers as proof of his sincerity. Understandably, Picard did not want someone who had put his entire species on trial to validate their existence. He vehemently denied Q's request, believing humanity was prepared for anything they could face. Q rebuts this decision and flings the Enterprise across the galaxy directly into the path of what will be the Federation's greatest enemy, the Borg. Their encounter with this technologically advanced species doesn't go well, and ultimately Picard asks Q to save the ship and its crew. Q parts by telling Picard that if humanity wants to explore the galaxy, then it promises a universe of wonders, but they must also be willing to confront the dangers they have never imagined. Picard comments with another crew member later on that perhaps Q did the right thing for the wrong reasons, to shake humanity out of its complacency for what lies ahead. Is this the last time we encounter Q? No, of course not. He reappears in the third season and is much less of an antagonist. The next time he arrives to disrupt the Enterprise crew, he's very much a changed being. As a result of his irresponsibility and meddling with humans, he's been punished by the Q continuum and stripped of his powers and immortality. He arrives on the Enterprise seeking refuge and asylum. Even though the crew remained unconvinced of his sincerity, they allowed him to remain on board temporarily. While accompanying crew member Data on a mission, they're attacked and Q uncharacteristically commits to sacrifice himself in order to prevent further harm to the Enterprise and its crew. At the conclusion of the episode, another Q arrives and acknowledges RQ's selfless act and restores his powers as a reward. Toward the end of the series, Q is more of a friend than a meddling trickster. In one episode, he seemingly helped Picard correct some mistakes he'd made in his youth and renew his lease on life. In the series finale, Q reveals that the trial on humanity had never ended and that they were found guilty. However, he stated it was Picard who was accidentally responsible for the destruction of humanity. Q helps Picard across past, present, and future to figure out the anti-time anomaly, which will eventually end humanity before it comes into existence. Following their success, Q revealed it was all a test from the continuum. Its aim was determining if humanity was capable of expanding their understanding of advanced concepts of the universe. Throughout the series, Q uses all manner of illusion, manipulation, deception, and conjuring to prove that humans have the potential to one day be even more powerful than his all-powerful continuum. He appeared as an adversary with tricks and trials, but ultimately, intentional or not, he proved himself as an incredible ally to the human race and the helping hand to its salvation.
I really miss Star Trek Next Generation, I have to say. Last up before our TV dinners is Heidi Kalloo. Heidi is a graduate of Swarthmore College, where she majored in English and minored in Japanese. Heidi has a deep love for the unusual and subjects and objects and intersections. She also loves cats. Cats, yes. I'm so happy, I have to say, that she has joined the full-time staff of the Writer's House. I think she's made a huge difference here, and I hope she's here for many years to come. Tonight, she's speaking about Adventure Time, another show I have never seen. Please welcome Heidi.
Oh, that was so nice. I'm so happy to be here, and I hope also to be here for many years to come. Oh, okay. It's in presentation mode. All right. It's going forward now?
Yeah.
I can't see it. Sorry.
Oh, wait. Can you not see it at all?
No, I can't. Because I think it's in a...
I duplicated these.
Okay, cool. Hi, sorry, technological difficulties. So I'm going to talk to you about Adventure Time, which is my absolute favorite show. And I didn't write like a thing, so I'm just going to talk to you. But I feel like that'll parallel the vibe of the show, which is off the cusp, but also like verges towards the poetic. So I'm going to talk to you about magic and Adventure Time and magic, madness, and sadness. So a little background. The Adventure Time mythos takes place in a landscape in an earth, possibly a Seattle, that is 1,000 years into the future. And it is post-apocalyptic in the sense that there was a nuclear catastrophe that eliminated most of human society. And 996 years later, we arrive at this adventurous landscape where our heroes, Finn and Jake, are exploring the land. Oh, and some more background. So in the story, in the series in the beginning, the characters use the expression, "Oh my glob." And then later on, glob appears as a character that is basically God. Glob is a malevolent deity who lives on Mars with Abraham Lincoln. And people in Ooh worship Glob like God. Although it is very plain that he is neither perfect nor omnipotent. And in an episode called Glob is Dead, he explodes in space. And then there's Galb, which is like an embodiment of chaos. You could call him Satan, I guess, if you wanted to continue the biblical allegory. So on to magic. In the Adventure Time lore, magic has always existed in the universe, and the Adventure Time universe is like the same universe that we're living in, just in the future. But the interesting thing is that magic doesn't make anything better. It doesn't solve anybody's problems, and characters have to deal with that when they think that it might magically fix everything. But they are, their plans are foiled by unforeseen complications. According to Princess Bubblegum, magic is just what people call science that they don't understand. So because of this, science and magic are conflated into one, representing a human desire to introduce order into a disordered universe, as well as ego-driven desire towards power. And this is illustrated through two romantic tragedies, Magic Man and Margles and Ice King and Betty. So I'm going to talk about these two characters, which are like two of the most important magical figures in the story. So Magic Man is Glob's brother, and he used to live on Mars until he was banished. And I have this quote about him that I think does a really good job of summarizing his importance. Magic Man is the complete subversion of the traditional Gandalf Merlin conception of the magical guide. Typically powerful, wise, and fostering, Magic Man manages to be all of these things with the additions of abject immorality and disregard for others, and with substantial amounts of glittery pizzazz. Instructive, yes, but primarily self-serving and chaotically playful. In fact, chaos has always been his favorite lesson. The most representative Magic Man moments involve taking a character's limited worldview and exposing it to the hopelessly vast intricacy of the universe, which often looks like utter chaos and unfairness to mere mortals. In Adventure Time, he's the perfect vehicle with which to discuss the mysterious iniquities of our reality, the existence of evil, the reason why bad things happen to good people, the apparent lack of order in anything at all. Magic Man is the embodiment of the universe's inherent and random injustices, the type that breaks the rational human mind. And that's from the annotated Adventure Time, which is like an online blog that I highly recommend. And it talks about all kinds of critical analysis as with Adventure Time. And then we have Ice King, who is one of my favorite characters. So Ice King is the remnants of the archaeologist from our time, Simon Petrikov, who's been made mad by his magical crown. He's forgotten all of who he used to be and is replaced with childlike obsessions around being seen as cool and finding friends or love. So another quote, "What makes Ice King such a great character is the way his different modes and different personalities become a stand-in for a wide variety of problems, ranging from the intense Alzheimer's disease and depression to the unfortunately relatable, being so awkward no one wants to hang out with you. He's got a giant psychic itch, and he's constantly scratching it in ways that makes the problem worse. For people who frequently deal with anxiety and stress through goofy humor, Ice King is a years-long I felt that meme. There's a dangerous lesson in Ice King's appeal as a character. His crown is a powerful metaphor precisely because it allows him to give up personal responsibility. The prospect of pawning off your actions and decisions is as powerful as and tempting as ice magic itself, even when you haven't had the time to make a tragic bargain. But, I forgot about those gifs. Okay, and then we have their romantic interests, Betty and Margles. Betty is an archaeologist and Simon's fiance, and Margles is Magic Man's wife, who was eaten by Galb. And the show uses their romantic narrative to illustrate the ways that love can develop into obsession, manifest in self-sacrifice and martyrdom, cause depression and insanity, and the loss of the individual self. And one way it does that in the magical narrative is by illustrating interiority. So I'm gonna show you a clip. So Betty is on a quest to save Simon, Ice King. And she travels inside Magic Man's mind.
Life grows in me.
To do that.
Nothing to weed, nothing to seed, pure and perfect. Like the marble floors of a bank, you slide with no obstacles. Forever blank.
Whoa. It really is like he said. Sort of cool, though.
The key.
Wow.
Aha!
Bingo.
Margles. Open your eyes, Margles.
Who's that?
I'm Magic Man, and that's my sibling, Glob. Hi.
So, I love this clip because it shows these characters traveling through magical means inside themselves. So Betty is traveling inside Magic Man's mind, which he says is a complete void, until she finds the key in her pocket, which is a Margles mask, and she becomes his love when she puts on the mask, and that allows her to go deeper into his mind to find his true self. And in doing that, we're transported back into a memory of Magic Man's.
I could. You hear me, Magic Man? Do you hear me?
Little guy said, is he...
Oh, that clip should have come first. But it's fine.
I could. You hear me, Magic Man? Do you hear me?
What's all that yelling?
Little guy said to see me go.
Well, there it is. What remains of your brother, Glob?
What remains? Tell me what remains. Some loser smashed out your brains. End of song.
So this thing's really gonna transmute you into the new Glob?
Of course, and then I'm going to make it rain on Mars in a bad way. Fire up those ovens, honey. This is exciting.
A little sad, though, right?
Which part?
Your brother blowing up in space? Doesn't that mess you up?
Nothing messes me up.
I don't believe that. Like, who is Markles, and why is there a picture of her on your shelf? Something there connects to who you are and your magic.
Someone shines a light into my dark wizard matter. A way to unclose the circuit of magic, madness, and sadness.
That's right. MMS runs through all magic users. I've hung out with scores of them, all displaying varying degrees of magic, madness, and sadness. Studying these symptoms could lead me to their underlying cause, and then I'll control the forces that hold sway over Simon.
I see.
You see what?
The coconut crab who swims in your neighbor's pool at night. Maybe Simon's in there too. Who else holds their breath in there, Betty?
All magic users swim in the loomy gloom.
Finn and Jake, if you could...
That's the end of the clip. That's Tiny Manticore. He's a great character. But anyway, sorry those were out of chronology, but it's okay because the Adventure Time series tells us that time is not linear. So Betty is trying to use magic to save Simon, but the story tells us that you... I completely lost my train. I'm so sorry. Okay, I have one more clip that is of Magic Man letting Betty see into her own mind.
No, I know. 6 months studying ancient petroglyphs in the Outback. I can't believe it. That's me.
Adoy, you look so happy and sane.
I was, but I never took that trip. I met Simon the next day, and he was just so amazing. I put everything on hold to help him search for the Enchiridion.
Listen, Betty, I may not be a psychiatrist or a life coach or even know what you're talking about, but maybe you should try focusing on yourself a little more, you know?
Can I, though? I spend so much time dedicated to Simon, I'm not sure there's even any me left anymore. Good point, future Betty. Maybe it is too late to save you, but with your power and my joie de vivre, maybe the two of us could save Simon together. Think about it.
Oh, come on, Betty, get it together. Even if you are a lost cause, she, or whatever she represents, is not.
Or am I?
So what I love about this moment is that it's a complete subversion of the regular romantic tragedy martyrdom narrative, which regularly one love is completely giving themselves up for the other love. And through illustrating Betty's interiority, we're reminded that it's really important to keep to remember that you have to love yourself. So if I'm using Adventure Time's magical existentialism as a model for my own self-reflection, what it tells me is that it's okay to be sad and scared because stuff is sad and scary. The world could end in a nuclear apocalypse at any moment, but that's okay because it's the natural order of things to go from order to disorder and then to order again. Also, facing up to your true self and the self that is hidden inside and masked by ego, ambition, or anger is the only way to heal. Being brave and adventurous and heroic means growing as a person, and doing that means reflecting on your mistakes and deciding to change. And my favorite message of the Magic in Adventure Time is that everything will be okay in the end. Thank you.
That's our writing about TV. Let's have one more round of applause for Jamie Albrecht, Erin Cross, Rodney Dailey, Torinn Fennelly, Mikey Ilagan, and Heidi Kalloo. I hope you will all join us for TV dinners. Thanks for coming.